Welcome back. So this is the second session from brain. Now we move on to heart. So now Dr. Kumaraswamy Raghala's lab will be presenting on the topic getting into the matter of heart. So this lab focuses on understanding various cardiovascular disorders. In today's talk, they are going to discuss briefly about the structure and function of heart, the circulatory system, and why it is important to keep our heart healthy. So now I hand over to Abhishek from Raghala's lab.
So good morning, everyone. I hope I'm audible. I'm Abhishek, and we from Dr. Kumaraswamy Raghala's lab will be taking you on a journey of getting into the matter of the heart. So in this show, we will show you how the heart is formed, how the heart functions, and how all the blood vessels come together and make a working circulatory system to keep us healthy and keep our well-being good. So to start with, life begins when the father's sperm and the mother's egg cell fertilize to form the zygote. From here, a single cell has to form the entire being that we are today. In this process, one cell, two cells, so many cells form. As it grows bigger and bigger, the nutritional demands increase, and a simple blood flow system is not enough. And in a growing fetus, the first organ system to be formed is the heart and its blood work of blood vessels comprising our circulatory system. Even in a pregnant mother, the very first sound heard from the fetus is that of the heartbeat. As seen here, this is an image of a chicken embryo with its heartbeat and its network of blood vessels. So, as the fetus grows and it becomes fully developed, the heart becomes the size of its fist. Interesting fact about the heart is, in a single day, it beats 100,000 times, and in the process of a single day, pumps 7,500 liters of oxygenated blood. This is in one single day. The heart is one of the only organs that is continuously pumping right from its first beat until the time we die, until its last beat. And during the process, it is estimated that over 70 years, it will have pumped close to 200 million liters of blood. So how does the heart do all this? I mean, the heart has to separate oxygenated and deoxygenated blood. The heart has to make sure that there is proper blood flow, blood does not flow back. When we look at the anatomy of the heart, we find that there are two chambers in the heart, one that separates oxygenated blood and one that separates deoxygenated blood. Further within these two chambers, there are two compartments called the atria and the ventricles on either side. Now, the purpose of the heart is to receive oxygenated blood and pump it to the rest of the body, and also receive deoxygenated blood and pump it back to the lungs for further circulation. How does it do this? So, let's say I've taken an oxygen, and now when I'm breathing in this, it is going into the lungs, it is entering my blood. From the lungs, it is coming to the heart in the left atrium. From the left atrium, it is now going into the left ventricle. This flow is being controlled by a valve. Why is this valve needed? To prevent blood from flowing back and to maintain a single blood flow channel. From the left ventricle, it is now pumped into the biggest blood vessel of our body called the aorta. Then, once it goes into our circulation, the blood oxygen is now taken by our cells, all our tissues, and now the deoxygenated blood has to return back to the heart for recirculation. This is done by the vein or the vena cava. It comes into the right atrium, comes into the right ventricle, and is pushed back into the lungs. To give a better view of how important our heart is in our circulatory system and how essential our circulation is in itself, let's breathe in air. So we're breathing in oxygen, we're exhaling carbon dioxide. What happens is, in the lungs, this oxygen from air is taken into deoxygenated blood and carbon dioxide is taken out through a process of gaseous diffusion in the alveoli. Now, this freshly oxygenated blood has a long way to go before it reaches the very depths of our tissues and penetrates all the body parts. It then takes the route of the pulmonary vein to reach the heart. From the heart, there are two express lines, one that will carry oxygenated blood to the rest of the body and one that will carry back deoxygenated blood to the heart for a fresh dose of oxygenation. So here is a picture of an artery and a vein. So these two express lines are designed so cleverly by the body such that it has to separate blood flow, in that an artery carries blood that is going away from the heart and a vein carries any form of blood coming towards the heart, thus creating two independent channels of blood flow that can never mix together. But ultimately, all the circulation returns back to the heart. In tissues, however, what happens? So a single huge blood vessel has to travel a long way and has to travel in the deep depths of every tissue for blood flow. What happens is aorta or arteries at veins branch out further into arterioles and venules and then capillaries. And these penetrate the very depths of the tissue, and there they exchange oxygen, and the deoxygenated blood is now sent back into the express line for recirculation. So I hope we now understand that how our heart is an essential part of the circulatory system and how our blood vessels in essence are itself very important for the circulation. But how are these blood vessels formed? These, during our early development and right until our adulthood, the process of angiogenesis creates blood vessels. So when you're a kid, until you grow to an adult, blood vessels keep getting longer, keep branching out more and more because the demand for blood and oxygen increases. The more we exercise, the more we grow, our blood needs to supply more oxygen to more places, and blood vessels grow larger and deeper. This also happens during wound healing. It also happens during exercise. Interesting facts about blood vessels are that if you laid out your entire set of blood vessels and capillaries, it spans 60,000 miles. And red blood cells from a single person, if you stack up, it goes 31,000 miles as high in the sky. And we breathe in a lot of oxygen in a day, right? To give you an idea of how much oxygen we breathe in, 1 gram of hemoglobin can combine with 1.3 ml of oxygen. And in one single red blood cell, there are 270 million molecules of hemoglobin. That's a lot of oxygen. Now, I hope we have an idea of how important our circulatory system is and how robust and efficient it is at making sure that blood is circulated to every corner of our body and we get the oxygen that our body needs for our well-being. Now, in the recent years, scientists have been finding out that cardiovascular diseases are very prominent. These are very dangerous diseases because anything that affects our heart will affect the rest of our body in the course of time. In 2015, heart diseases overtook cancers as the number one killers. Here is an interesting infographic from one country, US, or country like US, where 1 million people have heart or suffer from either heart attack or a coronary heart disease. 16.5 million people are living with a coronary heart disease. 15% of people who smoke are prone to heart diseases. 38% of people who are obese are prone to heart diseases. So this is sort of just highlighting to you all that cardiovascular diseases are significantly influenced by so many things, and they are emerging as very important killers in today's world. So what are these cardiovascular diseases? So we can separate them as cardiac disease, those diseases that affect the heart, and vascular diseases, those that affect blood vessels, just for our simplicity. So we shall talk first about vascular diseases, that is diseases which affect blood vessels. You have one called abdominal aortic aneurysm. So the aorta is the biggest artery in the body. What does it do? Carry oxygenated blood to the entire body, from the heart to the rest of the body. Now, when blood flow happens in a blood vessel, it's basically in pulses, and blood is pushed, so the aorta then contracts and relaxes, and also blood flow happens. In a diseased aorta, what happens is the blood vessel cannot come back to its original position, and because of this, it keeps ballooning and eventually bursts, causing death. Another vascular disease is called atherosclerosis. What happens here is that in a blood vessel, mainly because of lifestyle habits, there is a deposition of cholesterol and fatty substances. What these do is form a sort of solid mass that sits on the blood vessel and forms a plaque. This plaque then starts narrowing blood flow. And what happens when we narrow blood flow? Oxygen reaching the body is less. The heart has to work more. There's more demand, even though the blood flow is the same. This can be very serious diseases because as the plaque grows larger and larger, it can completely block the blood vessel and it can form a clot, causing stroke. So when we right from being kids until we grow into adulthood, until we grow old, we can be affected by so many disorders. As we age, our heart also ages, and what we do every day, what we eat every day, and how we are every day can significantly influence how our well-being is. So cardiovascular diseases are significantly influenced by lifestyle. Not to say that you will get them if it happens, but they are quite possible that you will have a high probability to get it. Let's say eating fatty foods, drinking, smoking all have a higher propensity to cause high blood pressure, cause coronary artery disease, where a block is formed in the blood vessel that feeds the heart. And these ultimately can cause stroke and death. So we can see that just as we age over so many years of our living, simple things that we do can cause a higher propensity for us to develop cardiovascular complications. But just like we get injured in a finger, right? It starts healing. You see the small scar forming and your finger's back to normal. Of course, it did hurt in the process. But in this, the heart also gets injured in a process like this. So when the heart gets injured, our body also wants to repair it. But the repair is not as simple. In an injured heart, the cells that replace the site of injury are not able to help the heart function at its best. And as a result, the heart may look like it's repaired, but it does not function like it's repaired. And this in the long run is also dangerous. This is a condition called cardiac fibrosis. Now, I've talked about how lifestyle influences cardiovascular diseases. I've told you about how injury influences cardiovascular diseases. But sometimes these are not in our control. We are just born with cardiovascular defects. How is that and why is that? So nothing is perfect, right? Even during our development, there can be a few tiny defects that can cause our heart to not form properly. And this has certain complications. So one is called patent ductus arteriosus. What happens is that in an early embryo, the oxygenated and deoxygenated blood are not segregated from each other, but have a small channel to bypass the lungs until the lungs are fully formed. Sometimes as we grow, and once the fetus is fully formed, within days, this channel is closed and the oxygenated and deoxygenated blood are completely independent and they use the lungs. In some babies, because of the heart not forming properly, this channel is still open. It's not a life-threatening complication, but what it causes is mixing of the bloods and it causes more load on the heart. Another complication is in aortic valves. So as I've said, aortic valves are flapping, you know, so they flap open and blood flows, they flap close and blood stays in. So these regulate blood flow and they make sure it goes in a single channel. Sometimes when in a healthy heart, there are three flaps. Sometimes some people are born with two flaps. What happens in this process is not that the flaps don't work or the valves don't work, but what happens is that there is slight leakage and it is not as efficient as it should be. And to meet the growing demands of the person, it can cause complications. One such person who had this was Arnold Schwarzenegger. That's not why he became a Terminator though. He did get surgically operated and he did get his valve replaced and he's now healthy. Another such cardiovascular complication is called teratology of Fallot. This is a huge complication of four different cardiovascular malformations or four different parts of the heart not formed properly. One is that you have one part of the heart which is so muscular that it's not able to pump blood properly. Then the segregation between oxygenated and deoxygenated blood is not fully formed. And the major blood vessel that's supposed to transfer blood to the rest of the body from the left ventricle is not positioned correctly. To top all this off, you have the one blood vessel that carries deoxygenated blood to the lungs narrow. So all in all, it causes a very severe complication, not being able to breathe, not pumping properly, a mixing of oxygen and deoxygenated blood. This person, Sean White, an Olympic medalist, suffered from this. However, he in 2008 or 9 underwent three open heart surgeries to correct this malformation. So we can see that cardiovascular diseases are of so many types. We can get them either by doing nothing, just because of some malformation as you're born. Although these are not so prevalent, we can get them because of lifestyle habits. We can get them because of injury. But in all these, we need to know what is going on here. We need to understand what happens when the heart gets injured. Why does the heart behave the way it does? So we in Kumar Swami Regala's lab at CCMB study cardiovascular diseases and try to understand the molecular mechanisms that lead to the heart not functioning at its best. So to do that, so another thing that happens with the heart, which is the most important thing that happens during our lifestyle, is when we exercise. So we exercise regularly, right? All of us build muscles, we build biceps, and the muscles become bigger. Athletes keep running, training for hours, And what we think is healthy, right? Our heart's growing bigger, bigger is better, but that's not always the case. What happens is the heart, as it grows bigger, the muscles also grow bigger, and sometimes that can lead to a faulty pumping action. The heart is not able to pump enough blood. It's so big and it's so muscular that it cannot pump enough blood to meet the body demands. This is a condition known as athlete's heart. If you read in 2012, this footballer's heart stopped beating for 78 minutes because of this condition. So we in our lab focus on studying cardiovascular diseases to understand the molecular mechanisms that affect them and try to see why is it that the heart is not being what it's supposed to be. We do that in two ways. First, we isolate the beating cells of the heart, that is called cardiomyocytes from animals. And then we try to get them to a state where they're not well or they're diseased and see what's going on there. We try to go into the molecular details. And then to make more information and more sense out of it, we use mouse models where we surgically create a sort of cardiac hypertrophy or a sort of heart pressure. We create overload and then we see what's going on. Why is the heart disease? And in that diseased heart, what molecules are going wrong? One such surgery we perform is called transverse aortic constriction. In simple, the aorta is narrowed to reduce blood flow. And in the process, because our body is not receiving enough oxygen, there is a lot of back pressure on the heart. The heart has to pump more and more and more because it thinks that the body is asking too much oxygen. It's not able to deliver. In this process, the heart becomes huge. It becomes hypertrophic, which we can see in our image here. Now, we then dissect out this heart, we study, we make cells out of it, we may isolate several molecules of the heart, and we study what is actually happening here. We also have at our disposal a very unique tool. So just like humans go for echocardiography, right, and we go for 2D ECGs almost every day to check whether our heart is functioning at its best, what's going on here. For animals, just for us to know better as to how the heart is actually going from being healthy to being diseased, we use animal echocardiography machine, so ultrasound. So what we do is we have an anesthetized mouse and we then make it diseased either through some form of injection or through some form of surgery. And we are then looking at two things. One is the cardiac disease and the vascular disease. So we look at the heart beating. When you see the heart beating, this hollow cavity represents where blood flow happens. This is the left ventricle. And these are the walls of the heart. And this is the aorta. When we make the heart diseased, what happens is either the heart becomes bigger or the walls become thinner or the walls become thicker. We can then visualize this with ultrasound and then look at the molecular aspects and say that, okay, this is what is happening in a diseased heart when we do this. And that gives us more information on that cardiovascular disease. In another scenario, we also study aortic aneurysm where there is ballooning of the aorta. So we are able to visualize it with ultrasound and we are able to say that, okay, look, it's the aorta is not what it's supposed to be as an healthy animal and the blood flow is affected. And these two tools allow us to address what is happening in cardiovascular diseases much better. And we also do a lot of molecular analysis to understand why cardiovascular diseases happen. So for more information, you can log on to the CCMP website and Dr. Kumaraswamy Legarao's group to study what we do. We thank you all so much for watching this show. You can stay tuned in for the quiz. I will be happy to take any questions you may have now.
Hi Abhishek. So these are some questions. There is question, what is angiogenesis? There is one
question. Okay. So angiogenesis is the process of formation of blood vessels. So during our development, for our circulatory system to form, the heart needs to have blood pumped through some channel. And this has to go to the depths of tissues, right? This happens through angiogenesis, the process of formation of blood vessels. So blood vessels give rise to arteries and veins. Arteries and veins then branch out to give arterioles, which are smaller and penetrate deeper, and then capillaries, which penetrate the tissue's depths. I hope this answered your question.
One question is, what is coronary artery diseases?
So coronary artery diseases are generally diseases of the blood vessel that supplies blood to the heart. So the heart by itself is also an organ. Even though it pumps blood, it needs blood for itself. And the coronary artery is one that supplies blood to the left ventricle. If you remember, the left ventricle supplies blood to the rest of the body. Coronary artery diseases are generally those that affect coronary artery, and it can be in the form of an atherosclerotic plaque that blocks the artery. Because it's small, even the development of a small plaque can block blood flow and eventually cause stroke, and it can cause the heart to stop working. It can cause something called an infarction. I hope that answered your question.
I hope the previous session was informative for you people. So I have few interesting facts about heart. Let's see how many of you know the answer for those. So do you think all animals have heart? And can you name some heartless animals? Like, do all of us really need to have a heart? Well, not really. Because there are some jellyfish, starfish, sea cucumbers, and corals. They are very primitive animals and they don't have any vascular system. It's all open for them. And can you guess how many chambers are there in fish heart? We know that in humans we have 4, but in a fish heart? So we have 2 chambers in the heart of a fish. Here in this video, you can see the 2 chambers beating, right? And one very interesting fact that as the life evolved from the water to land, as we move from fish to amphibian, reptiles and birds, the chambers of heart also increase. Like in fish, we have 2, amphibian have 3, reptiles have 4, they also have 3, and birds and mammals have 4. Then next is, how many hearts does an octopus have? So usually we need to have only one heart, but octopus, they have 3. It's very interesting, right? And what causes the sound of a beating heart? We can hear our heart beat, right? So what is the sound when? So we discussed that there are valves in the heart which prevent the blood flow. They open and close in after every contraction, right? So this opening and closing of valve, this is the reason why heart makes sound. And when doctor, they put stethoscopes, they try to hear this sound. So this image, this video, you guys must be familiar with it, right? So what is the instrument which gives this result? So in case you don't know, this is called as electrocardiogram. It records the electrical activity of the heart. It helps doctors to assess the condition of our heart. So we understood a lot about arteries and veins. So is there any artery which carries deoxygenated blood? Usually arteries are known to carry oxygenated blood, while veins are known to carry deoxygenated blood. But there is one exception to this. So the pulmonary artery, which sends the blood away from the heart to the lung, it actually carries the deoxygenated blood. While pulmonary vein, it brings the blood back from the lungs to the heart and it carries the oxygenated blood. So which of them has the fastest heartbeat? So we have a shrew, human, and a cheetah. Cheetah is the fastest animal, right? But does its heart also beat the fastest? Well, the answer is no. Shrew, the smallest animal, its heart beats around 1500 beats per minute. While us humans, we have around 60 to 100 on an average. While cheetah is around 120. So there's a very interesting correlation. The smaller the size of animal, faster its heartbeat, while the bigger the size of a mammal, bigger the size of animal, the slower it is. For example, shrew heart beats for 1500 beats per minute, while a blue whale only 4 to 8 beats per minute. Interesting, right? And last question, do RBCs, our red blood cells, do they have any nucleus? So in humans, we actually don't have any nucleus. These cells, as they are made, they die after 120 days or so. But some birds' RBCs, like chicken RBCs, they have nucleus. So here you can see the stained nucleus in the blue, right? So I hope the session was informative for you guys. So yeah, that's all.
Thank you, Priyanka. It was a wonderful session. So to all the attendees,